Thank you. And just a quick check, can you see my screen with Broadcom on?
Yes, I can.
You can? Excellent.
Yep.
So welcome back, everybody. I hope you enjoyed your lunch, or some of you will be breakfast, a very early breakfast, or maybe even supper time for you. But welcome back. So yeah, we're running a little bit behind schedule, only by about 5 minutes, not a problem. But up next, we have Mary and Steve, who's joined us from Broadcom. And I forget whereabouts you live now in America, but I know it's a very early start for you today. Welcome. So Mary and Steve have actually pre-recorded their session. So I'm just going to play that back just now. And so they'll be on hand at the end of this to answer any questions you have. So don't forget, post your questions in the chat. Don't be afraid. Any comments that you've got, you know, bring them on, and we'll try and get through them at the end. But without further ado, enjoy this next session.
Hi, welcome. Welcome to the Broadcom presentation at GSC UK. We have a presentation today, Enabling Cross-Functional Security Insights to Identify, Monitor, and Remediate Risk. My name is Marianne Furno, and today we're going to talk about, discuss reducing that risk by getting cross-functional teams involved and delivering more insights to them so they can make good decisions, and taking a little bit of a different approach to that. I have been leading portfolio level strategy and working to evolve the Broadcom mainframe security portfolio. I've been with Broadcom/CA for the last 20 years, and all within the security realm. And I'm joined today by my colleague.
And my name is Steve Hosie, and I've been doing as an active security practitioner within the mainframe security realm for the last 34 years, practicing cybersecurity and compliance. And I look forward to adding value in this session to all of our attendees.
Okay, so a brief agenda. We'll stop here and set expectations. We're going to take a look at change always in the environment, and what types of things that we need to be responding to in today's world. We're not going to spend a lot of time on that, though. We're going to move quickly into keeping pace with that change and how to do that, and implementing a layered approach to reduce risk in the environment. And then, you know, reducing that risk requires not only layered security controls, but cross-functional input as well. And involvement of various team members is absolutely imperative. So how do we include this expanse of folks in all of our efforts? So some of the change that's occurring today, right? We know the workforce has changed. In fact, before COVID, we had a much smaller base working from home. And now that COVID has been here for the last year, almost, you know, 88% working from home on a regular basis. And what we need to keep in mind, you know, because this isn't news to any of us, is that this may forever impact our working world and the way that we operate. Many HR leaders and CFOs are planning for remote work to be a bigger part of our lives long into the future. But what does this mean to us? For one, we have more distractions at home. We've got people working in mainframe that are in various places in their careers. So you may be distracted by kids, getting them off to school, kids needing breakfast, kids needing, you know, anything from mom, dad, or a caregiver, all the way to just your spouse who is nicely offering you a cup of coffee. But distractions can lead to more unintentional errors, not paying as close of attention to what you used to do. And in the security world, that can be critical. And the second thing is that folks are less checked at home. They might be more apt to partake in unbecoming behavior because other company staff is not around to just keep them grounded and or have some oversight into what they're doing. And then, of course, the biggest issue is that all of us are a much bigger threat, or a much bigger target, I should say, for social engineering attempts that we all know are larger than ever. So speaking of social engineering, brute force, as you can see, or use of stolen credentials is the top cause of breaches. And since we're all a mainframe audience here, we know that these breaches are mostly on distributed systems. However, something to think about is we see in in surveys, for example, the reuse of passwords from system to system, or a simple rotation or extension of a password from site to site. So brute force and stolen credentials comes back into play. If a user's password is compromised on just one of those sites, it's much easier for them to get into some of our high-value systems that are traditionally considered back-end systems. So paired with that is, where are those compromised credentials used? And we pair that with compromised devices. 40% of breaches involved are compromised web app servers, leading to exposure. And when we think about that in terms of the mainframe, we can see that these new opportunities and new mechanisms of reaching our clients and our employees are making their way to the mainframe, and in fact have made their way to the mainframe. And this changes the context of mainframe operations significantly. So we talked about the people shift, and now we're talking about the operational shift within the mainframe. So two things to consider here. You know, we've been exposing the mainframe more and more, putting different workloads on that open it up over the years. And we mentioned, you know, the web applications, but also take note in this list is DevOps and APIs. They're so convenient. They just make things work under the covers, in particular the APIs. So many of those web applications, even if they're not running on the mainframe, they're hitting backend data that resides on mainframes via those APIs that are created. So have we ever stopped to ask ourselves, what's the security of those APIs? That's another key area for concern. And let's think about that for a minute. Steve, when you meet with organizations, what sense do you get that their applications, their API generating development staff is trained in how to secure that API?
Marianne, it is a huge concern today with the mainframe and opening up the mainframe to the new APIs from a security point of view, as well as finding skilled security personnel that understands that and will roll forward with the challenge. Finding folks in the development area, the community that's skilled in security is even tougher. We used to talk about DevOps. It's now DevSecOps, and security is in the middle name of DevOps. Many things the API developers need to consider is security. How is the data returned? Is the end user scoped to see that data? Is it properly scoped to that end user's access requirements and functionality they're assigned? Are the input parameters for that API call, are they validated to ensure security? Is the data encrypted from point to point, from mobile to mainframe through that API? Are proxy IDs in use, and how are they secured? And so many more complexities that go into this equation. So yes, it is a huge concern today. However, all in all, I think we need to rethink our approach to our perception of the mainframe as a high value, low risk systems. We need to think as high value, rising risk, but there is good news.
And yeah, I agree on that assessment. That's what I hear from customers as well when I'm talking to them about their development staffs. And the security teams in particular, they just feel a little bit overwhelmed in all of these areas that, okay, we've got new workload going on, we've got different folks touching it, and they're not, you know, cybersecurity skills are hard to find. And a skilled developer who's an application developer with security skills is difficult as well, because that's not typically their foundational training is in security. So another oversight that we have to have. But you're right, Steve, there is good news, because when we look at the environment and the different controls that we have available to us, typically what we see leveraged quite extensively in the distributed world is some of that extension of core security. And we look at the extensive security policies that are available throughout the enterprise. Identity and access administration, very strong. And we've been strong in that for years, extending that to complex passwords, extending it once again for an even deeper authentication of the user, different configuration compliance, a key concern with, of course, the social engineering and the shifts and changes that we see is management and control of privileged users, classifying our data so that we know who's getting access to what, and so on. And when we move to the right side of the screen, what we typically see is an underutilization on the mainframe. And that's because we see that that high, what you mentioned earlier, Steve, high value system, but low risk. So back comes into play with all of these different changes. Contextually, there's rising risk, but what we have is the controls that are available. We just need to utilize them. So beyond putting controls in place, Steve, what else should we consider?
That's a great question. In addition to modern mainframe cybersecurity tools, the organization must have measurable, documented technical security standards and an overall written mainframe security governance plan. When we talk about technical controls, we're really talking about a standard security technical implementation guides that document what the measurable, documented technical standards are. Why have documented security standards? You need them to be documented so they're measurable and verifiable to truly make sure that security has been implemented fully and properly. Without that, you don't have a valid method in order to ensure compliance. What is a STIG? A STIG is a common acronym that's in the market space that stands for Security Technical Implementation Guide. It is a collection of those technical controls that take you from your regulatory requirements to your broad security controls such as NIST or others, down to how do you implement those requirements on that particular platform, in this case, the mainframe. It's not just a configuration of the system. It's a collection of controls that go from configuration of the system or software solutions that are on that system, on that mainframe, all the way to who should have what access controls based upon the roles that those individuals are within. It's a well-defined and measurable set. Auditors or internal compliance teams will be able to help you validate and verify that you truly have your mainframe secured. It will fully utilize your external security manager. No more internal security, no more guessing at, are we secured? How are we secured? And are we writing log event records, security event records for what is being, for violations or for critical security permissions being granted? It does document the infrastructure roles and suggested baseline controls for those. Who should be providing the STIGs? Well, in my humble opinion, I think it should be the vendors of the software solutions should be providing their own security technical implementation guides on how best to solve the concern of security on the mainframe. If you're implementing their solutions on your mainframe, shouldn't you be expecting them to provide those security implementation guides? And here at Broadcom, we're leading the way. In addition to security technical implementation guides, you want to have a robust mainframe security governance plan, or as the NIST 850-3 refers to it in PL-2 control, a system security plan. System security plans cover many things. They cover the why, the what, the who, the how, the where, and the when. And when it's completed, it really does document the entire life cycle of cybersecurity of your mainframe. It gives your compliance team a roadmap on where to verify and validate and to ensure compliance. It gives your internal auditors measurable controls to validate that you have, in fact, implemented least privileged access. You have, in fact, implemented access control requirements or continuous monitoring. It's a robust roadmap. It gives you that complete life cycle for all the team members that are involved, that touch or are touched by mainframe security on the mainframe platform.
So Steve, when I see customers, you know, going back for a second to the governance plan that you had talked about and the implementation of the STIG guidelines and so forth, we kind of see customers, I would say, all across the gamut. Do you agree? From starting off or fixing up what's currently there to very mature in these processes.
Absolutely. We see customers all over the place with that. There are some that are just starting the process of writing a governance plan. some that are looking at, we need a governance plan, we don't have one even started yet, all the way to the customers who have a very mature mainframe security environment where the governance plan is fully documented, implementing all the controls and moving forward with how they're securing the mainframe. So it's, we see the whole gamut of that. Absolutely. That's what we've seen.
Yeah. And I think the best thing is just working with wherever the customer is to help them get to the next step on where they want to be. Because security, you know, if we wrap all this up and, you know, we started with some of the contextual changes and the rising risk in the environment and the need for to get a plan in place, because that is the getting everybody on the same page and getting them a common goal in the background. But we know that security can't be a one-man show. You know, we've got security teams that are involved for sure. We and at the heart of everything, we have our application teams from the business. We've got auditors, compliance folks, and of course users. So how do we get all of these people on the same page moving forward, taking into consider security so that we don't leave our mainframe systems as low-hanging fruit? But we also know that the mainframe is so complex. There's hundreds of systems that can be connected with different mechanisms. And we want to make sure we have an understanding of this so that, you know, if we can use an analogy here, we don't want to leave our front door or lock our front door, but then leave the sliding glass door in the back of the house open for somebody to come in, especially on a system like the mainframe where data is persistent for sometimes decades and still very relevant in the world. Securability of the mainframe is top notch, and given the importance of the data there, it really, we want it to keep that crown. So we can achieve this by invoking this community of folks that we've got listed on here, and really the community of folks within the whole ecosystem, get them thinking about security and communicating about it. And once they're given the insights, they can use some automated tools and manage risk and have that conversation. And one of the ways that, you know, we're suggesting is implement that zero trust framework in your environment. And if you're not familiar with zero trust, the little bit of a clash that may be caused on the mainframe is because mainframe has some culture with it. And sometimes a zero trust model or framework, even though it tries to be as less intrusive and less behavior changing in an inducement as possible, it is verify every user, every device, at every boundary, which the mainframe is a boundary, enforce that least privilege. So the user may have to change some behavior in terms of how do I get an elevated privilege. It might not be sitting on their user ID 24/7 anymore, because we're basically taking the assumption here that we're going to be breached. And so if any ID is compromised, if the system is compromised, you want it in a state where things are least accessible as possible. So let's take a look at what this might look like on the mainframe environment. We're going to start at the top left, and we have users who are coming into the system, and they are accessing from the internet your environment. They're going to probably use a multi-factor authentication method, so we have a deep trust in the identity of who they are, and we're going to take that into account when we look at some context-aware policies when granting them authorizations. Those policies are also going to do some real-time evaluation. They're going to look at different factors in context of that user. And when they go to move over to the right side there and hit another software-defined perimeter, because we're venturing into the mainframe, we're going to say, okay, we have the option to, again, use multi-factor authentication. So we have a good, solid trust of them coming onto the mainframe. They come onto that platform in a bare bones, basically not able to access much except their own assets, their own data sources, and so forth, some fairly benign resources on the system. Everything else, they're going to be carefully controlled and monitored. They're going to have to elevate their access to get to them. If they're a privileged user, even more so. We've got, you know, very granular controls for those authorizations. And then, of course, they're going to be continuously monitored in that environment so that we have a good idea of what they're doing. And, you know, we mentioned here that you know, it takes a whole ecosystem of folks to put this in. And we've centered here on this is the path of a typical user and administrators of the system. But let's take a look at that cross-functional team.
So the cross-functional team is very important. In fact, communication, dialogue, and collaboration within cybersecurity is a challenge, but it's also vitally important to the success and the end goal of making sure the customer's data is secure, your operating systems are secure, the applications are secure, so forth. Back to the system security plan or the governance plan, part of that is also cross-functional, and who all can utilize that document is cross-functional, from the compliance team members, the security practitioners, the system programmers. And as we note here, the communication is vital to ensure that they're all at the same table. They're able to sit and collaborate together and communicate together. From a security practitioner standpoint on the mainframe, and probably from other platforms as well, I know for a fact that it's a struggle for some of the security practitioners or system programmers or managers to realize that the compliance team, they're really there to help you. They should be your friends, not your enemy, and treated as, hey, they're at the same table. They're there as peers, as equal, in the same end goal, result, desire of secure systems and secure data. Let's try to be a little more kind to them and open up our communication with them and ensure cross-functional communication is effective and that we're all at the same table together for the same end result goal.
So, Steve, I would, and I hope if there's any auditors in the audience or any compliance team members that were not offensive here, but I wish we could open up a poll and ask if you have swayed anyone's opinion of the compliance team and the auditor team members, who very much are here to help us, but unfortunately they put more work on our plates at times.
Indeed.
Okay, so Steve talked about very many roles and coming together and having a good dialogue back and forth. And what makes that difficult is that some of us speak business terminology, some of us speak security terminology, some of us look at things from a regulatory standpoint. So in essence, you know, three different languages just in those roles that we've factored. So how do we have a good discussion where we're all kind of level set on the same foundation and have a good understanding of what we're looking at, a good interpretation of what we're looking at, and then how do you remediate any risk? And I kind of liken this to some of the security reports that are available today. If I look at them, some of them are a little bit cryptic. And if I were to send those over to a business person, they may look at the report and nothing is really going to jump out at them. You know, a special attribute that might be on a user, they're going to just read it for whatever the name of the attribute is and think, okay, well, I'm not sure what that means, but it's not jumping off the page at me, so I'm going to move on and sign off on this. But if we had the ability to make a visual for people, so this way we can call out focus areas that we want them to have because they're labeled high risk. Think about what a game changer that is in terms of having that cross-functional communication, because I am going to see this report as a business person and I'm going to go back to my security team and I'm going to say, three of my business assets are labeled high risk. Why is that? And here the recommendation says, you know, X, Y, or Z, you know, for example, maybe it's clean up this data set because no one's using it, or maybe it's, you know, there's rule creep here or entitlement creep, and nobody needs to have this entitlement anymore because it's not being used. Maybe it is something has wide open access and I can turn that down. That's a very different conversation and is actually leading to action, which is what we want, because that's what's going to reduce the risk in the environment. So a visual represents common language for these cross-functional teams to communicate with. It gets the communication going. And we're starting with items that they care about, because this is a list of assets that's in their environment. And it's, again, a little bit of a shift for our security teams, because although the items that Steve pointed out earlier with the governance plan that is really for all of us as an organization, and the STIG, which is more so a concern of the security administrators and the platform and the security of the platform itself, now the security team is really being a service and offering a service to all of these business lines and enabling that, because we're giving them some automated tools with an assessment and an interpretation of what that data is, enabling that conversation back and forth. So it brings those cross-functional teams, team members together. Steve, another area is continuous monitoring, which helps these cross-functional teams. How does that work?
So on the prior slide, you mentioned and pointed out some of the critical areas of the mainframe. And we've talked about collaboration and having a common language between all the different players that come together for mainframe security. When we talk about continuous monitoring, it's known to have solutions readily available off platform in the distributed world. And now we're bringing to the mainframe modern mainframe cybersecurity tools that provide the continuous monitoring in those critical areas. One of the first things that the overall team needs to look at is, what is your organizational policy about continuous monitoring of critical mainframe areas? Some organizations ship all the security records down and flood their SIEM with a whole lot of noise. I recommend that you look at what are the critical areas that you want to monitor and that you should be monitoring. And so we've put some of those ideas on the slide in front of you. And some of those are the ESM critical controls. Whether you're ACF2, RACF, or top secret, what are the control settings for your ESM? If they're changed outside of a maintenance window or outside of an approved change, why would you not want to know about that? Of course you would. So there's other critical areas too that you want to monitor, like SIS1 PARMIB changes. You want to definitely not just know that it was changed, but what was changed in that, because that's absolutely critical. SIS1 PROCLIB, APF, LPA, and linked list libraries, you want to monitor those. If some bad actor or an employee is doing bad actor behavior in Unix system services world, and they're changing security using Chown and making all sorts of UID zero level changes or other privileged access usage, you absolutely want to be monitoring that and know, hey, something's going on over there. That's actually where the hacker world and hacker conferences are teaching people how to hack mainframes, is actually through the USS side first and how to leverage that to compromise your mainframe platform. There's other critical privileged access areas, like who has access to download or upload critical files or download your security databases. Hopefully that's locked down, and that gets back to the STIGs that say who should have access based upon roles to what critical areas in your mainframe. Bottom line is, you want to ensure what, where, and how continuous monitoring is being performed in the mainframe, that it's not just implemented, but you've also documented that in your mainframe governance plan.
Yeah, and Steve, you mentioned the USS security, and that goes hand in hand with what we talked about earlier with those stolen credentials and or the web applications, because we know that's where they live and run in a mainframe environment.
Absolutely.
So we're going to summarize this presentation for you. And the first thing, you know, we want to reflect upon is getting a plan in place. You know, this really is the first step towards engaging others. Everyone has the same vision and expectations are set. That plan should be put in place. That plan should be summarized for all stakeholders in the environment at an appropriate level, of course, for them and in their language. You might have to do a little bit of interpretation, but that goes a long way. You know, first step is always communicating. So get the plan in place and communicate it. And then better insights. So whether that is the layered approach with the zero trust model that we talked about, so that we add insight into each step where we're verifying and validating, and then also better insights because we're enabling communication with cross-functional teams. They get better insights, they can ask questions, or they get proactive notifications because they've got continuous monitoring insight, which enables everybody then to make decisions and act upon those decisions, reducing the risk in the environment. And then the last one is stay secure. You know, on this platform, on the mainframe, we've always set the bar high. To this day, it is known for its securability, and we will continue to do so with everybody contributing to security. So Steve and I thank you, and we are going to stick around for Q&A at this point.
Thank you very much, Mary and Steve, for that. You make a very good double act with your session. So thank you. Does anyone have any questions for Mary and Steve? Do we have silence? No questions?
It's Kira. I have a question. Do you find that it's easier to talk to auditors, risk managers, people like that, using sort of general, I'm going to say, CISSP type language or a control framework rather than trying to talk mainframe at them?
So this is Steve Hosie. I find talking with auditors, you just have to understand that they come to the table with perhaps the Windows knowledge. So how do we translate that to mainframe and open up that discussion to say, how are you doing that on the other platforms, or what's your background? And then try to bridge that gap, sharing the knowledge that on the Windows admin is this, on the mainframe, we have more granular controls for system programmers than just giving them UID0 as an example. And share with them the knowledge about what's important on the mainframe and why it's important to secure like Cisco and Quantum Live, and what does that mean? They don't have the knowledge, generally speaking. They have a lot of knowledge, don't get me wrong, but they come with a depth of knowledge of other platforms. So how can we share and help them learn together to provide a better compliance validation of the security controls in the mainframe, and to make that relationship a building bridge activity versus a confrontational, you're here to audit me and find findings. I found that a happy auditor doing an audit or internal compliance certainly makes for a whole lot better review. Does that help you?
Oop. I'll keep muting myself. I find traditionally it's easier to talk to them, say, in their language rather than ours. And I have also actually found that you can use your auditors. It's a two-way street. When you want to fix something, you explain it to them in terms they understand. They'll make it a finding for you.
Absolutely 100% accurate statement. Yes. And that is so true, because often you get so frustrated from the mainframe security side of things, and we're somewhat tunnel vision focused at times. But working with the auditors, it's very handy to show them, hey, this is something that, you know, is a concern. Is this something that would be a concern for you? And then explain to them why, and then let them go with, they might document it, and then it might get reported, and then it might get fixed. Absolutely. It's a great exercise. And I welcome the idea that we partner with them and we're at the same table. The end resulting goal, desired goal for all of us, is more secure systems. So I think that's absolutely spot on.
Just to add to that, Kira, as well, I mean, I had an interesting, there's a couple of people on the call right now who I actually work with. And there was a guy that we used to work, he recently left the organization. And I forget who said it to him, but it said something about, oh, they've got update access to APF authorized libraries. That's a major risk. And his response was, no one even knows what that means. It's like what he was trying to say was, can you please translate the language, you know, from what on earth does APF mean? And I have seen that a few times where, you know, and I'm guilty of it as well, where you're talking to like people in the CISO land or, you know, very senior management, you're trying to get their focus, you know, because you want something fixed, you want some money for something to fix something. And when you talk in that language, it's just, they don't understand it. And it's that, like you say, that translation between, you know, the sort of the mainframe speak, the sort of technical terms into something that they, you know, can really understand. So I think that's something that, you know, a lot of us have to get better at, or use someone as sort of kind of a vehicle in between that you kind of, you know, they get it, but they can sort of help, you know, translate.
So Jimmy, you're spot on that. And just recently with a customer, I wrote a very technical report, and Marianne was so incredibly helpful to assist and make that translation to go from highly technical to more plain language. And that's something that a lot of us technical security practitioners have struggled with, is how do we go from a detailed report, a detailed focus, narrow focus, to a more broad, plain language to explain what the actual risks are in a more acceptable higher level executive terminology, if you would. So it's condensed and not quite as into the weeds. So it is a struggle. And the best thing is to think about some of the stuff that we have to write as risk. We must write that from mainframe ease or mainframe language, the dialects we have with the different ESMs, whether it's RACF, ACF2, or top secret, different dialects of the same mainframe security language. And we have to then take that and put it into a risk point of view. What is this in plain English terminology as risk? How does this impact the enterprise? And at what level? If it's not in plain English, where it's very clear, concise, it's going to be probably lost when it goes up the channel. So that is a struggle. Absolutely. We just have to work on it better. And I think improving our relationship with the compliance and the internal auditor teams will help greatly improve the communication there and the collaboration so that we're all working to the same drumbeat, to the same end goal of secure systems.
Yeah. I mean, it's the other kind of side of that is that I think some like technical people, and I struggle with it as well, you know, trying to articulate, what does this really mean? What is the risk to the organization? And in the past, I have actually used people from like CISO, like who've got the risk that are employed, you know, to, you know, do all, you know, they eat risk basically. And I think if it's an area that you really do struggle with, the sort of the translation, that to use someone in those areas to help you, you know, convert it. But there's something that I just actually, Lenny, I don't know if you want to unmute there, because it's a very interesting comment you made.
Hi, Jamie. Sorry, just a moment to unmute.
Sorry.
Yeah, I recently had a set of discussions with auditors. I was implementing an encryption for datasets project, and there was a security assurance team that wanted to go over everything that we were doing. And one of the guys there didn't have much mainframe experience, and he went away and spent a couple of weeks reading up on what we were doing and what a difference it made to the conversation. Yeah. It really helped. So I think, as well as explaining things in terms that auditors understand, mm-hmm. it's not unreasonable to expect them to put some effort into learning mainframe language.
Indeed.
Okay, that's really about it, Jamie.
Yep. Okay. Thank you, Lenny. The other thing I was going to say was around the Mary, the graphics that you showed. You know, the dashboard with the sort of the risk status and stuff. I mean, that for me is like their eye openers itself. And again, if we can sort of sometimes, because I saw like things like Proclib and APF and so on there. I think sometimes translating that, you know, would add a lot more value, you know, into when someone like a manager was looking at it, or someone who's making a decision, having to make a decision that, you know, they, I see you've got some buttons there to kind of like recommendations, and there's maybe an explain more, some more context behind it. But that's the kind of thing that their eye catches, aren't they? Red, amber, and green.
Yeah. That's the tricky thing, is having that layer so you get attention upward, but then at that fine line, it does have to get detailed, because somebody has to really go in and fix it. And you don't fix abstractions, you fix detailed things.
Exactly. Yeah, absolutely. The other thing I wanted to mention was the kind of the gap. Like I saw the slide where you've got like on the distributor side, all the things that, you know, that our distributed colleagues would do, you know, MFA, the usual firewalls. And then there was kind of very limited number of points on the right hand side of your chart around what we do on there and the mainframe. And so that's I was going to try and get your thoughts on that more, as to why are we not doing a better job of exploiting the functionality, because we've got all the technology there. I mean, I was having a discussion with somebody the other day from CISO, and he said, you've got MFA for mainframe. You know, it's like, yes.
Why are we not doing a better job? I think it goes back to what we talked about in the presentation, and that is, we hear this from our customers, it's still considered high value system, but such low risk. And I think because perhaps fires have been common and focus has been on those in other platforms or other areas for so long that it's been cemented and the cement has dried with that low risk perception, and that continues to persist. And so it really is an educational effort to say the mainframe is evolving, the mainframe runs modern workloads, those same risks that existed and have been addressed elsewhere need to be addressed over here with the solutions that are available.
Yep, excellent point. Any questions from anybody else? No? Okay, well, Mary, Steve, thank you so much for your session. Like I say, it's really, really interesting. And like I said before, you make a very good double act together. So thank you for taking the time to do that for us and for coming, getting up so early in the morning to attend our session.
So, cheers, thank you.
Thanks once cheers. Again. Thank you. Okay, so we are up for another break now, ladies and gents. So we've got a 15-minute break. So we'll be back at 2:15. And our next session is with Robin from RSH Consulting, who is going to be talking to us.